When we look at self-service password reset from the perspective of an administrator, there are a few items that I'd like to show. When we log into self-service password reset, the homepage here at the end, you'll see there's an administration tile. When I click on the administration tile, I'm taken to a dashboard where I'm going to be given some high-level statistics for the last minute, last hour, and last day. This is going to show me the number of requests, sessions, total number of password changes, as well as overall authentications and intruder attempts. On the lower section, you'll notice that we have these in a graphical format. Across the top, I have some different tabs here. The first showing me the health of this environment. So we'll look at the configuration, the application itself, the LDAP connections, and show you how they're doing, whether they're healthy or they need to be looked at. The About tab is going to show you which version of the solution you're running, as well as how long it's been up and running and the installation date. The other section here is User Activity. This is a pretty valuable section that you probably use the most out of any of the others that I've discussed. This is where I can come look at my current active web sessions. I can also look at intruder events and audit records for my users, the help desk, and the system. So my user events are going to show me any time a user has accessed the application and made changes or authenticated. So in this case, I have a few authentication events for my user account. And we also made a few changes to the profile. So if I come here, I can look at exactly what has changed. You'll see there, it is going to record when we modify the configuration, as well as set our responses for challenge response. So as an end user, when they first log in, all of these audit events are going to be tracked. Now for our help desk users, we also track all of their events. So when they look at details of users, or when they set a user's passwords, or when they send a token to verify users on the phone, all of those audit events are tracked. And finally, we have system events, which are mainly going to record startup and shutdown events that you have. Of course, you can export all of these to a CSV file. I'd like to point out that there is logging available through the solution as well, and you don't have to log into the appliance to get the logs. We have a log viewer that's available from the dropdown where you can clearly see what's going on with the solution. You can export those logs to provide them to support when needed. The final item here on the menu is the configuration editor. This is where you'd come to make changes to the self-service password reset configuration. Up at the top, you'll notice a search bar. Because there are a lot of different menus here, the search bar makes it easy for you to find something when you don't necessarily know where it is. So if I was looking for something like entropy and I wanted to find where we have all of our entropy settings, come and type entropy, hit enter. It's then going to show me the four locations where entropy is referenced. So let's start out with policy mapping. When we calculate the score of a password, we do have the ability to map that entropy score to a password policy. And this is where that's done. So the four different settings, low, medium, high, and very high, can be associated with a password policy. In this case, we're leveraging the eDirectory configuration. So I will drill into security, we'll drill into password policies, and you'll see these are my available password policies in the directory. So with self-service password reset, I can define that password policy that suits the entropy scores for the users. In my case, I say that an entropy score of 20 will have the 90-day policy. That those that have a medium score or that of 45 or greater will have a 90-day policy as well. Anything of 75 or greater will get a 180-day policy, and anything over 100 will have the no expire policy be set. If I come here to the left-hand side and look for a second at policies, you'll see we have two types of policies, our challenge policies and our password policies. Let's talk for a second about the challenge policies. These are all the challenge response questions that we've talked about previously. From here, we're going to have them based upon language. And you can, of course, come in and customize these. So to do that, you would click on the language of preference. And from this screen, you can then add questions or customize the current questions. If I were to add a question, you'll see that down here at the bottom. And by default, we have these set up as admin defined. But I can also select user defined, in which case the question wouldn't be set up by the administrator, but we'd allow the users to enter this when they're defining their challenge response questions. You'll notice I can define a minimum and maximum length, as well as the maximum characters from the question that are in the answer, as well as applying a word list or not. So for my example, I'm going to go ahead and set up a new admin defined question, and that's going to be where's your favorite beach? I'll go ahead and click OK, and that question will now be available in the list. For password policies, we do have the option to create our own password policies within self-service password reset, or we can configure the solution to adhere to your directory password policies. I wanted to highlight this because there are a lot of password settings that we can set up based upon your requirements of the organization. So of course we have things like minimum and maximum length, but we also go into a lot of detail on whether we're going to allow numeric characters, allow the first character to be numeric, allow the last character to be numeric, how many numeric characters, whether we allow special characters, whether that special character can be the first character and the last character. Again, the number of special characters, both minimum and maximum, and then alphanumeric characters. So regardless of your requirements, our password policies can be set up to meet the strictest requirements for password policies in your organization. The next section here you'll see is our modules. Our modules are broken into two sections, public modules and authenticated modules. So when a user logs into the solution, they are authenticated, and these are the options that are available to them. If you don't want to make certain features available, maybe people search isn't something that interests your organization, you wanted to disable that, you can certainly do that. If it's something you do want to use and it's not meeting your requirements, maybe you want to have additional attributes available, this is how you would come and you'd customize people search to include additional attributes. The public modules are used for when somebody doesn't know their credentials, and we're going to have to validate that user before we give them access to the solution. The forgotten password module is the one that's used the most. And if you'll notice, we have the ability to create profiles here. So when we set up our solution, we can define exactly the verification methods that are used and how many of those are required before we say a user has been successfully verified. So in this environment, I'm saying we have an optional required of one, but of course I could change that to two if need be. If maybe I wanted to ask questions of the user about their LDAP attributes, maybe we required them to enter their employee ID, I can make that an optional verification method. Sometimes we would come in and enable these for things like OAuth authentication or integration with our advanced authentication framework. The other modules that we use very often are the new user registration. And I want to highlight this for a second because you mentioned you would like to be able to leverage the new user registration for bringing on board contractors. You can, again, set up different profiles for new user registration. So we have a default profile here. But when I add new profiles, maybe this would be a contractor profile. This will allow me to have contractor-specific settings that might be different from regular employees. So for example, I can define the context from which users will be created. In my case, I want to have all the users be created under data, users, and active users. And then here are the available fields on our form. So we are going to collect their mail, their given name, their surname, If I want to collect additional information from that user, I can do that as well. Maybe upon creation, we want them to populate their mobile number. I can add that as a value. And if I scroll down, there are additional customizations that can be made here. For example, we have the ability to send an email verification or an SMS verification to that user. So those are the module sections of the solution, and it makes it pretty easy to customize whenever needed. If there are any questions, please let me know.